Diolch yn fawr, Glenn. Diolch am y gwahoddiad. When Glenn mentioned earlier that there had been three people from Wales already you're presenting today, I did ask the question as to whether the audience actually understood the first two. And I'm delighted to say that Glenn said no, they didn't have a clue what we were talking about. So I'll carry on my presentation in Welsh. No, I won't. I'll try and fill in on some aspects of the work of the ABPI. And I think Susan caught it quite nicely, really, earlier. The Association of the British Pharmaceutical Industry, the principal association of the biopharmaceutical industry in the UK, and we help our members talk to one another. We also help our members talk to others. And you're certainly an important audience. Glenn mentioned that perhaps we were new to the GS1 family. I'm not entirely sure that our members are probably new to the GS1 family. And certainly on our terms of our ongoing engagement, I hope you will see that it is a critical area for us, especially the patient benefits that will come from working with GS1, FMD and others. In terms of the valued partnership, I was given a sort of a heading of valued partnership, and to be honest, I've been very struck by the strapline I see in front, save thousands of lives and millions of pounds. From our perspective, we would like to think that that is precisely what the biopharmaceutical industry does as well. So I will cover some of the challenges. I will remind you of the role of medicines. I will touch on various issues associated with that. It would be remiss of me not to talk about PPRS, especially when we're talking about millions of pounds as well. And then I'll just carry on, really, from the conversation that Susan started in terms of FMD. So please bear with me. There's quite a few slides, and my glasses obviously don't operate at the bifocal strength that it needs to capture here. So I might actually have to turn my back as well, so apologies for that. But again, I'm sure you've covered the challenges that the NHS face or that the healthcare systems across the world face over the earlier today and certainly tomorrow. But the challenges are significant. They're all to do with efficiency, productivity, and an older population. In terms of medicines, we believe that medicines continue to have a vital role in terms of delivering healthcare. We see medicines as preventing life-threatening diseases, change previous life-threatening illnesses, and to improve the quality of life and reduce mortality across the board. They are the most common therapeutic intervention, and medicines take up about 15% of the overall NHS budget, so it's an important area. But there are issues, and the issues aren't new. The issues have been around for years, and the issues may continue into a more coherent serialisation and patient benefit world. Patients report having insufficient supporting information, poor adherence, medicines wastage, suggestion of 5 to 8% of hospital admissions being due to the misuse of medicines, mostly inappropriate prescribing and such like, or the wrong dosage, etc., etc. So not the right medicine to the right right patient at the right time. So to tackle these changes, we believe that that it's absolutely critical to find new and innovative ways to deliver services to patients, and we see that the pharmaceutical industry has at least a contribution to the dialogue as to delivering those new services. Extracting more value from the money spent in the NHS, one of the objectives, if not the major objective of the last for you today and tomorrow, and tackling the innovation component, which itself is a challenge. And that brings me to PPRS, really, and the pricing, the pharmaceutical pricing scheme for pharmaceuticals in the UK, and recently negotiated, or feels recently, it was back in 2014 that we actually signed up to the current means by which the prices of medicines is controlled within the UK. And it was pulled together and negotiated to address persistent low levels of patient access to innovative medicines. And we believe that the package, the deal, actually presents the NHS with a unique opportunity to ensure patients are getting the right medicines at the right time and less constrained by cost. It gives the NHS the flexibility to act based on full long-term value of medicines as opposed to the cost. Why do we say that? We say that really because this is a new type of scheme. Within it, the pharmaceutical industry underwrites the overall growth in spend by NHS on branded medicines for a defined period of time. And that is what it looks like. There is a defined allowance in terms of growth of branded pharmaceuticals within the UK. And up to 2018, that is monitored very closely by Susan's colleagues at the Department of Health. And it means that over that period of time, we will be refunding the NHS to the tune of about £3 billion. We've already hit the £1 billion mark. And in terms of what happens to that money, I know there's been long debate as to where that money goes to. The reassurance from the Department of Health is that money is fundamentally captured within the budget available and given to the NHS to perform its function. So we believe that the PPRS provides a one-off opportunity for patients and clinicians to find the right level of usage of branded medicines based on clinical factors rather than primarily cost. For the NHS, the medicines bill growth has been underwritten, so commissioners have the opportunity to remove barriers to clinicians choosing which medicines they would prefer to use in consultation with their patient. For industry, what are the benefits for industry? Well, believe it or not, this capping exercise provides the industry with a level of stability and it supports innovative companies, but there is a level of risk attached driven by overriding austerity issues. And in terms of the government, that stability or that predictability is another key important component. And basically, harnessing this opportunity, very strong encouragement from the Secretary of State to actually make the most of this opportunity and for the industry to work with the NHS. And that's why this heading of this slide reads PPRS and MO, Medicines Optimization. It's another very hot topic that I'm sure Keith Ridge may have discussed today. It's one of his overriding ambitions to ensure that there is a profoundly better use of medicines in the UK, or certainly from the English perspective. And it allows local system redesign and an integrated care approach. It allows a move from the cost to the value discussion. It also allows new approaches of value to be introduced as opposed to status quo or the way things have been done over the last 20 years or so. However, we fully appreciate that medicines optimization, PPRS, even though it's a profound opportunity, it does have that challenge of progressing alongside a significant contribution of efficiencies that is expected on the NHS in the next period of time. So in terms of the value partnership, I've discussed about medicines in general, but now I want to bring you back in line with the conversation that Susan started in terms of patient safety and a recognition at the European level that there is a considerable amount of falsified medicines that reach patients through the illicit online pharmacies. However, there is that ongoing threat of falsified medicines entering the legal supply chain as well. The biopharmaceutical industry is committed to ensuring patient safety and actively engaged in helping secure that legal supply chain that it starts off, if you like, by in terms of manufacturing. So to enable that, the pharmaceutical companies are now committed, fully committed to delivering the obligations, the requirements of the Falsified Medicines Directive, and we will be adding tamper evidence devices on all our prescribable medicines from 2019, as outlined earlier. In addition, we will be placing GS1 compliant serialization codes on each and every pack that is prescribable pan-European level. I think Susan mentioned 1 billion packs in terms of the UK. You can expand that and roll it out quite a few times when you consider the size of this overall project. So those are two components, and those two components make up the safety evidence components of the directive. But alongside that is the means by which at least some of those components, some aspects of that serialization, can be used in a meaningful way as well to allow the verification and authentication of medicines. So in addition to individual member costs in terms of adjustments to packaging, we will also be investing at about £100 million across Europe in a IT system which allows the verification and authentication of medicines. And that is the timeline. So the objective, the content, and the timeline. So all of this done and dusted in an usable form well before the implementation date of 9th of February 2019. When we look at forward sort of planning and what have you, it's very rare that 3 years hence we have an absolute cut-off date for the implementation of an IT project. Well, in this instance, we do. And why we are confident that that we will achieve this is because ultimately non-compliance puts sales at risk, it puts supply to patients at risk. So it's absolutely fundamentally important to all involved that we do work collaboratively to achieve. A pretty picture in terms of what a tamper evidence device could look like, a rip-off strip there. But as was mentioned earlier, there are plenty of other types of tamper evidence device that can be incorporated onto packs, and I'm sure we'll see a variety. But in terms of the unique identifier itself, you'll see a representation of the 2D barcode there, and obviously the human readable format of the content of that barcode as well, just in case of scanning difficulties, etc. In terms of the overall principle of the pan-European model is that manufacturers serialize their packages, they enter that serialization code into a European hub. That pack then gets sent from the manufacturer to wholesalers, perhaps to another wholesaler, perhaps to another pharmacy, perhaps to another pharmacy, and anywhere along that chain, this system should enable those actors to verify the medicines along that path. It isn't a track and trace system, it is an end-to-end verification system. There are significant differences between those two that we may want to revisit later. But ultimately, as the patient receives the medicine, at that point or time of dispensing, however long that time and point of dispensing actually is, that unique identifier is decommissioned from the system. That's fundamentally the system that we have, and that is in line with the technical specification as outlined by the delegated regulation. This is another diagrammatic which captures the same principle but in a slightly different format. I mentioned the manufacturers will input their data into a single place. That single place, in terms of this and most of the jargon involved with this project, is quite a challenge in itself. But it goes into the European hub. The European hub then sends the messages to various national repository organisations, and it's actually the national repository that pharmacies and wholesalers at a national level engage with to verify and authenticate those products. Importantly to everybody who has to pay for this system, and basically my answer to that is everybody has to pay in some form or other. Certainly in terms of the installations for pack coding and tamper evidence, that rests entirely on the manufacturers, and as you can imagine, that in itself is a significant task. In terms of the ability to verify, because there are obligations within the directive, obviously, on pharmacies and wholesalers to verify medicines as appropriate and certainly to decommission them, there are costs attached to the installation of scanning facilities and changes in workflow, etc., etc. So nobody's minimising the costs involved here, I don't think. And in terms of the repository system itself, the ability to actually change that unique identifier into something meaningful that will say, yes, that medicine is as we think it should be. It's been input into the European hub, it's been transferred into the national repository, and you are now being able to authenticate that medicine. That system itself is paid for by the marketing authorisation holders. That means our members, it means members of the British Generics Manufacturers Association, and it also means members that involve themselves in parallel importation and exportation. So all marketing authorisation holders are involved in the price of this. The other challenge, Susan mentioned earlier, the challenge sometimes for our members to talk to one another, but this project demands that all stakeholders within this space talk to one another as well. The model is very, very clear from the Commission. And as such, we've pulled together the five principal constituencies, as we see it, to engage in developing this project at a European level. And what I have in front of you there is a reflection of those same constituencies that are based in the UK. So that means pharmacies there, wholesalers, and the marketing authorisation. Three constituencies as mentioned. And importantly, and Susan wouldn't let me go out, I'm sure, if I didn't mention this, all governed by stakeholders under the supervision of the national competent authorities. So where are we? Enormous project, lot to do. Delegated regulation published in February of this year that allowed everybody to actually get up and establish what was needed. Having said that, there have been years and years of discussion and planning well ahead of the delegated regulation. But basically, where we are in the UK now, we are setting up this not-for-profit organisation which will manage the system of the UK repository. We will then be entering a consultation with all stakeholders engaged in this area and would welcome views on our model and plans for the UK. We will then finalise the user specification requirements for the IT system, and at the same time we will select the IT provider who will deliver the UK repository. The start of the IT system build will be an exciting time nearer the tail end of this year. So we've all got a very exciting time in front of us. I'm sure you all have very exciting times yourselves, and I won't bother you any further. So thank you for that.